Ladies and gentlemen, the founder of Skeptic, Rebecca Watson.
Hello, Skepticon. Hello. Thank you so much. Thank you to my warm-up act, PZ Myers. Always a pleasure to have him here. He asked me to plug his new book, something atheism. I love Skepticon. It's my favorite conference of the year. Are you guys having a good time? This is, of course, my 26th Skepticon. It's only my fifth under the name Skepticon. Of course, prior to that, it was known as the Southern Baptist Convention, I think, right? I think. Heady days. So yeah, as Lauren mentioned, it's become a bit of a tradition for them to ask me for my talk title and slides and notes several weeks ahead of time, and the tradition is that I say no, because I don't know what I'm talking about yet. And so I apologize for that, but I'm sure Lauren will be relieved to know that this year's topic is a good one. It is, of course, an introduction to bridges. Can we get the thing on, maybe? Because I have a slide with a bridge. It's a great bridge, you guys. I'm not speaking about metaphors. I mean literally an introduction to bridges. Metal ones, wooden ones, ones that span rivers, ones that don't. I'm just going to keep talking about bridges until they get the projector working again. No, I absolutely know nothing about bridges. This year's talk is actually called Laugh Riot, Comedy as a Tool of Social Change. So we're going to be talking about comedy. And ironically, this will be my least humorous talk I've ever given. So buckle up, you guys. Bit of a content warning for you. There is adult language in this talk a bit. That's right. Fuck you, kids. And I know that we have a few people in the audience who are visually impaired. I will be describing all of the slides to you, and also I would like for you to know that I'm wearing some really rad tights. They have stars on them. I feel like we're so close to getting the projector up. And I can... Oh, there it is! I worked really hard on that slide, so I'm so glad you guys could see it for like the 2 second joke that it is. No, there's the real title. So yeah, let's talk about comedy. A couple weeks ago, you know, I'm on Twitter at Rebecca Watson, and I get tweets sent to me. And here's one that I got recently. Too woe to Wenty Aidite wrote, nothing you do is useful. And I read this as I was walking to the pharmacy to pick up a prescription, and on my way, I responded, untrue. I once did a dishwasher repairman. And then for the next 40 minutes, I just giggled to myself. Which is definitely the best way to go pick up a prescription, is to wait in line for half an hour, giggling to yourself. And when you get to the front of the line, to say, I'm here to pick up my pills for severe depression. Keep them guessing. But whenever I tweet something like this, which is pretty much my standard type of response to these people, usually I will get someone saying in return, what do you hope to accomplish by being so sarcastic? And for the most part, the answer is nothing. I just want to make myself giggle. But that is a goal in and of itself, because comedy helps us cope. And for me, comedy is this huge release. I get a ton of not very smart or compassionate or interesting people sending me really horrific things on a day-to-day basis. And the way that I deal with that is through comedy. And so whenever someone, I mean, it happens so often that people criticize me for using comedy as a response, that I started really thinking about it in terms of, well, what is the use of comedy? And is it just me who feels like this is a really awesome way to respond to vile things sent to you? And so I started looking into it. And what I found was that I am not alone. And in fact, there's a lot of really interesting research about comedy, about the use of humor, and how it helps us as humans, what it does, what it can do to the people you are being funny to, what it can do to you when you are being funny. And so there are a number of studies that support the idea of comedy as a way for people to relieve stress. And this is just one. This was a Stanford research team who showed subjects really horrific imagery, because that's what psychologists do for fun. And they asked people specifically to come up with funny captions to the photos. And so, as an example, one photo was a gruesome picture of a sort of factory worker tearing the guts out of a fish. And one response was, he always wanted to work with animals. Which is quite good, I think. And they broke down the responses by positive comedy and sort of negative comedy. I think the example they gave of a negative comment was something along the lines of, he finally found a job to mask his body odor, something like that. And then they tested people to ask them their feelings on these images. And what they found was that people who wrote comedic titles for these images were more likely to view the images through a more positive lens. They were able to process the images in a different way that made them less disturbing. And particularly for those people who were using the positive humor, that had a huge effect. But there was even an effect with people using negative humor. But, and also the same researchers have done several other studies that have shown that these sort of exercises of asking people to think about things in comedic terms doesn't just make them feel better about the images, but it also it helps them have more creativity, it increases their vocabulary, things like that. It has an overall beneficial effect on them. They've also found that even though the sort of negative, hostile jokes didn't do quite as well as the positive jokes, they found that with certain groups, particularly disempowered groups like POWs, they tend to get these dramatic benefits specifically from hostile jokes. So it's not just me who enjoys being super hostile towards awful people. And that's one of the ways that comedy can help us out. Another way is that comedy can help us learn, or it can help us teach others. So those of you who are interested in spreading critical thinking or science communication, this stuff is really relevant to you. It's something that the producers of Sesame Street have known for a very long time. And in fact, many of the psychologists who do research on humor in learning have been consultant on Sesame Street scripts. They specifically run them past psychologists so they can figure out how best to use humor to help kids learn. And I've chosen an example for you because he's my all-time favorite. I chose what I feel is one of the quintessential Grover skits. Hopefully this will work. Video is always tricky, but it works.
Waiter!
Just a moment, sir!
Waiter?
Yes, be with you in a moment. Yes, sir, Grover, the waiter at your service, sir.
Oh, good, thank you. I'd like a cheeseburger with French fries and a pickle. And I'd like it right away, please. I'm in a hurry.
To serve you is my only pleasure, sir.
Wait a minute. Aren't you going to write that down?
Sir, I'm a trained professional. I do not need to write things down. Instead, I use my waiter's memory.
Well, yeah, but I ordered a cheeseburger with French fries and a pickle. Isn't that a lot to remember?
Ha! Observe, sir. A trick of the trade. I remember things with a little poem. Listen. Round and tasty on a bun. Pickles, French fries, yum, yum, yum.
I don't believe this. Hey, how are you going to remember it's for me?
In a hurry to be fed. Beady eyes and big blue head. Okay, Charlie, put up.
Oh, that dummy. I'll stop it there. You can watch the rest online. Grover, still hilarious all these years later. But that's one of the things that Sesame Street excels at, is using humor to connect to their audience. So what we find is that what a lot of the studies show about using humor in teaching is that it should be all of these things, relevant to the subject you're teaching, it should be relevant to the audience you're attempting to teach, and it should be comedic, which I know seems obvious because we were talking about comedy, but you'd be surprised how many people forget to actually make things funny. Here's another study that I found very interesting. I like it particularly because this researcher has used one of the least funny subtitles in the history of research papers, how ha-ha can lead to aha. Yes, I definitely trust what you were about to tell me about comedy, sir. So Randy Garner's the researcher from Sam Houston State University, and he wanted to look at how humor in a lecture can help students process information. To figure out how much it helps, if at all, he chose a statistics lecture, specifically because statistics are well known to be the most abhorred class, apparently, amongst many college students. And he showed college students a statistics lecture that was on videotape. For half of the subjects, they just saw a pretty dry lecture on statistics. And for the other half, he edited in a joke. And the joke is this. A criminal is caught and sent to prison with a cellmate. And he tells his cellmate immediately, "I'm breaking out of here. Do you want to come with me?" And the cellmate's like, "Nope, you go ahead." So the prisoner works hard. Over several months, he finally manages to break out of the prison, and he finds that it is surrounded by desert, miles in all directions. So he's unable to get anywhere. They catch him, they drag him back, they throw him back in the cell. So he relates this to his cellmate. You know, it turns out we're in the middle of the desert. And the cellmate says, "Yeah, I know. I tried to break out a couple years ago. Same thing happened." And he goes, "Why didn't you tell me?" And he goes, "You should know that no one reports negative results." Okay, that got a bit of a laugh. I wasn't sure. Wasn't sure going into this. But the students also found it funny. And what the researcher discovered was that the kids who watched the lecture with the humor in it were more likely to give a very high rating in terms of the information that the lecture presented. They were more likely to like the professor better. But the biggest reveal was that they were much more likely to retain the information a while later. They were better able to remember the lecture. So just including like a small, very relevant, not that funny, but a little funny anecdote went a long way towards helping people learn. And most researchers seem to think that this is down to the fact that humor, when used in the classroom, can do a lot to just relieve the anxiety of the students. And it can also make the students like the professor more, which just overall helps grease the wheels when it comes to them paying attention and retaining the information. So in addition to comedy being able to teach us, comedy can also change our minds. And I found this particularly interesting because this is what I think a lot of us here are most interested in, is how do we convince the people around us to start thinking critically and, you know, stop being, I guess here, stop being fundamentalist people who are obsessed with your sex life. And it turns out that maybe comedy can go a long way towards helping persuade people. John Cleese had something to say about this, maybe. I wasn't actually able to find the source of this, but it's one of those quotes that's often attributed to John Cleese. He said, "If I can get you to laugh with me, you like me better, which makes you more open to my ideas. And if I can persuade you to laugh at the particular point I make, by laughing at it, you acknowledge its truth." Whether he said it or not, it certainly applies to much of his work. My personal favorite is The Life of Brian. And I'm sure that many of you here are familiar with it. It is the story of a man who is born just next to Jesus and is mistaken for being the Messiah throughout his life, and it becomes quite a pain, to say the least. And this is a film that was seen as quite blasphemous by many religious leaders at the time it came out, but John Cleese publicly argued that it was not in any way blasphemous. Jesus appears in the film twice, making it clear that this is not Jesus they're making fun of, particularly. This is a pretender, just a regular guy who is mistaken for the Messiah. And because of that, they hope to make it more accessible to people who might be fervent Christians, but still big fans of Monty Python. They could go see it with a clear conscience. And maybe they would walk away with it thinking a little bit more critically about religion. So with that in mind, I will play a brief clip from one of my all-time favorite movies. Brian is escaping a mob that is chasing after him with humorous results.
Faithless monster, faithless, go away! How shall we go away, master?
Go away, leave me alone!
Give us a sign!
He has given us a sign! He has brought us to this place!
I didn't bring you here, you just followed me!
Oh, it's still a good sign by any standard!
Master, your people have walked many miles to be with you! They are weary and have not eaten!
It's not my fault they haven't eaten!
There is no food in this high mountain!
What about the juniper bushes over there?
His word! They brought forth juniper berries!
Of course they brought forth juniper berries! They're juniper bushes! What do you expect?
Show us another miracle!
Do not tempt him, shallow ones! Is not the miracle of the juniper bushes enough?
I say those are my juniper bushes!
They are a gift from God!
They're all I've bloody got to eat! I say, get off those bushes! Go on, clear off, love you!
Lord! I am affected by a bold path.
I'm healed! The master healed me!
I didn't touch him!
I was blind, and now I can see!
Classic. But you can see what they were going for there. They're not criticizing, they're not attacking believers so much as they are attacking this mob mentality of religion and how religions are built and how they end up being worse off for believers. And I don't have the statistics on this, but I'm pretty sure that The Life of Brian did quite a bit for encouraging people to think critically about their religion. But we do have studies that show that other forms of humor definitely do have persuasive abilities. Here is one such example. It's humor in advertisements enhances product liking by mere association. And a lot of the research on humor and persuasiveness revolves around advertising, I think in part because they've got all the money to spend on this. And also because it's a pretty cut and dry way of seeing how people are in a short-term way immediately influenced by what they're seeing. And so in this case, it's a study where they showed people a mock-up of a magazine, and in the magazine were advertisements for a sports drink. Half of the subjects saw the ads positioned next to a cartoon that was humorous, and the other half, humorous but I should say unrelated, the cartoon was unrelated to the ad, and the other half saw the same ad in the same placement, but in this case the cartoon was not humorous. And I have the cartoons, I will show them to you now. For those who can't see, it is a toothbrush and a roll of toilet paper having a conversation, obviously. And the toothbrush says, "Sometimes I feel that I have the worst job in the world." And the toilet paper roll says, "Yeah, right." Okay, yeah. That's the humorous one. The non-humorous option, the toothbrush says, "I wonder what day it is today. Do you happen to know?" And the toilet paper says, "It's Friday." Way funnier, am I right? Way funnier. I don't know what subjects they pulled out to give this test to, but for some reason, the subjects polled said that they found the first one much, much funnier than the second one. I don't know what is wrong with them, but that's what the researchers want, so I'm glad it worked out for them. And what the researchers found was that people who saw, you probably know where I'm going already, the people who saw the ad positioned next to the humorous cartoon were much more likely to have a favorable opinion of the ad. Even though it was completely unrelated, they think that it was a form of conditioning. They saw the cartoon, they got a little surge of happiness, and they just related that happy feeling to the ad, and that's what they went away with. There have been many other interesting studies. I'm just gonna talk about one more in this line. This is a game from Lockheed Martin Corporation. They instituted an ethics office at their workplace, and they wanted to persuade their employees to contact the ethics office if they ever had any kind of ethical issue. And in order to train their employees to do that and to persuade them to do that, they made this board game. And they got Scott Adams, the creator of Dilbert, to draw specific cartoons of Dilbert and Dogbert to go on this board game. And they also gave multiple choice options for situations. So in one case, one of the situations was, let me see if I can remember this. You have to choose a bid for a job, and you notice that one of the bidders is your boss's husband. What do you do? And one option is, I award the bid to the husband. Oh, and the husband's bid was the lowest. So option one, I award the bid to the husband. Option two, I go to the ethics office, blah, blah, blah. And the fourth option was always what the researchers call, because I'm pretty sure this research was done by my dad, a wisecrack from Dogbert. And in that case, the wisecrack was break up the marriage, which I'll grant is kind of funny. And obviously, you know, you're not supposed to pick this one, but let's lighten the mood. And so some researchers used this game as a way to determine whether or not humor was effective, more effective at persuading people to choose the correct options than would be, you know, just a straight multiple choice with no wisecracks. They did several options. One was the game as is. Another option was the game with both the cartoons and the wisecracks removed. Another option just had the cartoons without the wisecracks, and the other option had the wisecracks without the cartoons. And what they found, by and large, was that the cartoons didn't really make much of a difference, but the wisecracks made a huge difference. Oh, and by the way, this is the study, if you're interested in looking it up, The Effectiveness of Humor and Persuasion, The Case of Business Ethics Training. The whole thing's online for free, which is always nice. They found that the use of irony was the biggest factor in persuading people to do the thing they wanted them to do. And what these researchers suspect, based on a lot of previous research, is that irony distracts us from developing counter-arguments to what we're being told. Because irony requires a second level of reasoning. And when we're engaged in thinking about that, we are missing an opportunity to come up with counter-arguments for whatever we're seeing. And this has been demonstrated in other studies. They're all very interesting, but unfortunately I don't have the time to go into all of them. I might write up a post on Skeptic a bit later. Because it is really cool. A lot of studies have even shown that the weaker the argument, the better irony works at persuading someone of your point of view, the more it distracts them from how terrible your argument is. So what we learned from this research is that humor helps put the person that you're targeting in a good mood, it increases their trust in you, and it can distract them from forming counterarguments. So how do we see that result in real life? Well, here is one way. This is an organization called Otpor. This is back when Yugoslav president Slobodan Milosevic was in power. He ruled by fear for the most part, and students wanted a way to disrupt that fear and delegitimize Milosevic. And the way they chose to do that was primarily through mockery. So what they did was they would hold a birthday party for Milosevic where they collected money to get him presents that included a one-way ticket to The Hague. They set up a barrel with his face printed on it and charged people an amount of money to come up and just punch the barrel. And they were hugely influential in finally bringing about change and getting Milosevic eventually ousted and arrested. Were they the only piece of the puzzle? No. But they were a huge part of turning their society from one that feared Milosevic into one that mocked him, which is just a tremendous shift of power. When you no longer fear something, when you see it as deserving of ridicule, suddenly it's a target that you can tackle and bring down. And that's what they did. Another good example, I think, happened pretty recently. If you've seen any of my previous talks, you know that I'm obsessed with the religious rights war on women. There was a bill introduced in one state to, in many states, but in this state in particular, to force women to undergo a vaginal ultrasound if they wanted an abortion. And the Senator Janet Howell decided to rebut that with mockery, and the way she did it was to introduce a bill that would force men to undergo additional medical procedures before getting a prescription for erectile dysfunction, which was awesome. Give her a round of applause, because that lady was awesome. This was in Virginia, by the way. It was House Bill 1, and that bill, unfortunately, her amendment to the bill was beaten, but the HB 1, also failed. Was she the only part of why it failed? Absolutely not. But she attracted a huge amount of media attention to what was happening in Virginia, and she probably did a great lot of good by focusing that spotlight on what was happening and getting people to care by using mockery. So I know what you're thinking at this point. You're thinking, this is all great, Rebecca, but how do I be funny? Well, I am here to help you. Here are several options for you. You can start anything with just knock knock, I found, or did you ever notice? Did you ever notice? You have to do it like that. Did you ever notice? Or airplanes, what's with those? You can substitute anything for airplanes. Conferences, what's with those? Or you can just slip on a banana peel. It's also very funny. How not to be funny is probably a little easier to go into. Rule number one, don't try to be funny even though you are obviously not funny. If you have friends, you should ask them, am I funny? Tell me for real. And get their honest opinion. If you don't have friends, you're probably not funny. So, I'm sorry. That is actually backed up by research, I swear to God. Funny people have more friends. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. As I was making that slide, literally, like, as I was typing it, I got a tweet from @langsquirrel, who gave me the perfect example for this. And this was in response to me tweeting a link to a video I did last week in honor of Carl Sagan. It was just five misconceptions about Carl Sagan. And he wrote, @RebeccaWatson, nice comeback, #RebeccaTwatson. Nah, just kidding. You're not coming back, babe. I'm pretty sure he thought this was hilarious. It makes no sense. Like, there was no comeback. Like, there was no, he didn't spell some of these words right. And he ended up just getting mocked by my friends. I went to get a screenshot of his tweet today, and his account's been suspended. So it did not work out for him. So let that be a lesson to you. You know, if you're not funny, if you don't think you're funny, don't try, because people can smell desperation. But studies do show that there's a way around this. If you still want to incorporate humor as a way to teach and a way to persuade, there's a very easy option. You can just use the humor of others. Use a Dilbert comic if you must. Use a funny YouTube clip. You know, the idea is just to keep making it relevant to your point, but there's plenty out there that you can crib from if you are not innately blessed with the gift of comedy. And of course, you know, again, don't try too hard. Even if you maybe you are funny, but if you're trying really hard to drive home some comedy, people can smell that. Again, they can smell the desperation. The best example of this I can think of is this parody website that a guy called Ed Clint made last year, I think, called Skepticunt. Do you get it? Do you get it? It's because it's like Skepchick, my website, only it has the word cunt in it. And here's an example of one of his parody articles. Book review, Mensation, the Science of Womanly Bleedy Time. And he went all out. Like, there are articles, there are fake comments on all of the articles. And it's not just Skeptic, he did it for all of Freethought blogs as well. And which is why I refer to this as his 90-hour cunt joke. Like in the time it took him to program all of this. Well, first of all, in the time it took him to program all of it, we launched a new design on Skeptic. Which I picture him looking at it just being like, God damn it! And also, I probably got laid like 200 times in the amount of time it took him to do that. I will accept that applause on behalf of my boyfriend. Thank you. So yeah, this is basically like, the slightly smarter version of this would be someone on Twitter saying, you're a cunt, girls have vaginas and they're gross, ooh. Like, that took 10 seconds. You know, if you're not gonna be funny, do it quick. Do it quick and get out. And so on the same topic, you know, the humor of womanly bleedy time, the science of womanly bleedy time and cunt as a joke, What the humor is there is that we at Skeptic are women who have, many of us have vaginas, not all of us, they're disgusting. And despite the fact that we are women and we have disgusting body parts, instead of being embarrassed by them, we are interested in the science surrounding them. So that's where the humor, that's what he was trying to go for there. And so that brings us to the third point, don't punch down. Women have been told for centuries that our natural bodily organs are disgusting and that we should be ashamed of them. There's the old joke that if men menstruated, there would be a tampon vending machine on every corner that also sold bait and beer. Because we're told that that's something that we should never talk about. We should be embarrassed about it. And that's something that we do try to fight back against on Skeptic. That's something that we think is unfair. We're trying to work towards equality. And so when I talk about punching down, good comedy punches up. Good comedy attacks power. Like the Yugoslavian example. That's good comedy, is a scrappy bunch of students going after a world leader who is oppressing them. What could be better than that? Everybody roots for the underdog. Nobody wants to see somebody kicking marginalized people while they're down. Well, some people want to see that. They're not here tonight. Lindy West put it very well. She was describing, this was in a discussion about rape jokes and how often people defend this sort of humor by saying, well, you know, no topics are off limit to me. I hit back against everybody. So here's how she described it. Oh, don't worry, I punch everyone in the face. People, baby ducks, a lion, this Easter Island statue, the ocean. Okay, well that baby duck is dead now and you're a duck murderer. And it's true, you know, it's just because you attack everyone doesn't mean that the effects of that attack aren't very different in very different ways. To give you examples of what we're talking about when it comes to rape jokes, I'm not saying that all rape jokes are off limits. What I'm saying is that there are rape jokes where the humor comes from attacking the victim. And as an example of both a good rape joke and a bad rape joke, I've pulled both from The Onion, which I, for the most part, very much enjoy. Here's an example of a bad rape joke. Fellow cheerleaders rally cheer of support for recently raped teammate. Now the humor here that they're going for is that girls in high school are peppy, cheerleaders are peppy, no matter what, and teenage girls get raped. You know, it's not a good rape joke. They make up for it with better rape jokes, like this one. Brutal gang rape gives screenplay more punch. The target of the humor here isn't people who get raped. The target of the humor here is Hollywood that uses people who get raped as a way to add drama to their screenplays. And so this is a really good way of being subversive and attacking the power structure, the existing power structure. As another example of a good rape joke, just to prove that literally anybody with enough thought can figure out how to use their comedy to punch up, I give you Dane Cook.
I think there's a word even more than gay being thrown around that we need to, you know, remove from our normal conversations, which is raped. People throw the word raped around too casually. Have you ever played like video games online and listened to the way people talk to each other, right? Oh, dude, you just shot me in the back. Dude, you raped me. I'm pretty sure if I sat down with a woman who's been through that horrific situation and I said, can you describe what this was like going through this? She's not going to look at me and go, have you ever played Halo? It's like getting hit in the face with a gravity hammer by a camper. You ever get an estimate on an automobile repair and then you go to pick up your car and it's double? It's just like that.
Guys, that occurred. If Dane Cook can do it, anybody can do it, all right? So what happens when we punch down? Am I saying all of this just because I find it wrong and weird and unfunny when people punch down? Yes. But also, there is science to support the fact that punching down is actively bad for society. Here's one example from a study called A Joke is Just a Joke Except When It Isn't. Cavalier humor beliefs facilitate the expression of group dominance motives. This was by a researcher called Gordon Hodson. And for those who follow me on Twitter, this is the study I was talking about when I tweeted that this paper includes one of the most bizarre corrections I've ever happened across while reading through a scientific paper, which is the last row of data should have read obese, not Mexican. There is context, which I will now give you. What these researchers wanted to look into was how people respond to jokes when the jokes are specifically targeted at a group of people. The study was done in Canada, and they used three different groups of people: Canadians, Americans, and Mexicans. And these three different groups represented an in-group, in terms of Canadians, a high-status out-group, in terms of Americans, and a low-status out-group, in terms of Mexicans. And they told terrible jokes, and I mean terrible as in kind of disturbing jokes, to a group of people to judge their reaction on whether they found the jokes funny and whether they found the jokes offensive. And what they found is that overall, and other studies support this as well, across all of their subjects, there didn't seem to be much of a difference between people who found jokes offensive and then later other surveys revealed were like blatantly racist, to put it lightly. But what they found was that when they broke down people in more specifically, when they looked at how certain people responded to certain jokes, they found some really interesting results. So one of the things they looked at was people who hold cavalier humor beliefs. These are people who took an uncritical and lighthearted approach to humor, and who believed that humor cannot cause any harm. And they found that those people tended to be much more prejudiced and to hold a preference for social hierarchy and for maintaining a social hierarchy. So those are the people who found the Mexican jokes absolutely hilarious and not at all offensive. And I have to tell you that the jokes, I'm not even gonna tell you what the jokes were because they were bad. So it's astounding to me that they found anybody who believed that these were humorous. But that's what they found, was that people who believed in the social hierarchy, who were invested in maintaining the social hierarchy, their views were actually reinforced by reading horrible, demeaning jokes about people in a lower status group than them. Here's one other interesting study, More Than Just a Joke, The Prejudice-Releasing Function of Sexist Humor. This study specifically went a little bit further to see how people who respond to bigoted jokes positively, how these jokes impacted their later behaviors. And what they found was, in this case, they were looking at specifically at sexism. And they had men fill out surveys, and they ranked them by their total amount of sexism, basically. What they found was that men who scored very high on sexism, after listening to sexist comedy, they were much more likely to cut funding to a hypothetical woman's group, as compared to other sort of student groups on a campus. They found the same thing happened in a follow-up experiment, they had sexist men watch sexist comedy skits and others watch neutral comedy skits. And they found the same thing, that men were much more likely to basically take money away from women's organizations and put them into other organizations. So what they found was that sexist humor did directly impact behavior. It made men, not only did it just reinforce their sexism, but it actually made them behave in sexist ways. Lauren is shimmying, which means I have 5 minutes. I'll try to wrap it up. So that's what this researcher found, was that humor's disparagement creates the perception of a shared standard of tolerance of discrimination that may guide behavior when people believe others feel the same way. Sexist humor is not simply benign amusement. It can affect men's perceptions of their immediate social surroundings and allow them to feel comfortable with behavioral expressions of sexism without the fear of disapproval of their peers. So basically, it legitimizes sexism and makes men feel like it's okay to continue being sexist because society is accepting their sexism. That's what rape jokes that have the rape victim as the target are doing. They're reinforcing these negative ideas of mostly women. I'll briefly talk about another interesting fact of comedy, satire. When it comes to satire, there have been several really interesting studies on whether or not that can change people's minds. Many studies have been done on the Colbert Report. If you're familiar, Stephen Colbert plays a right-wing conservative blowhard, and that's his whole shtick. So what this study did was they had people watch a clip from The Daily Show of Stephen Colbert interviewing someone from Democracy Now!, and they asked the subjects, first of all, whether they identified as liberal or conservative on a scale, and then to rate how funny they found Colbert, and also how they viewed Colbert's political beliefs. You know, is Colbert a conservative? Is he a liberal? Is he actually attacking liberals when he makes those jokes, or is he being sarcastic? And what they found was that both conservatives and liberals found Colbert equally funny. So it's not that somebody is, you know, not getting humor at all, but conservatives were much, much, much more likely to think that Colbert was genuinely targeting liberals, and that Colbert himself was conservative, Republican, disliked liberals. While liberals, of course, did not perceive that. This is a guy who... This is a guy who poses for photos like this, literally naked, wrapped in the American flag in front of a fireplace. So satire can be very tricky because on the one hand, it can be used to rally your base, but on the other hand, you could be contributing to the other side saying, yeah, screw those liberals. We've seen this in the atheist sphere as well. This used to be one of my favorite websites. I don't even know if it's still updated anymore, but it's the site with Lambule, and it's all these little cartoon characters that are Christian, but there are these like weird little subversive jokes hidden inside that give away the fact that it's satire. Like this little elephant saying, hey Habu, how many gods do you have? I don't know, I lost count. It's completely like over the top ridiculous, but I am positive that many Christians have seen this and think it's absolute 100% real, and it probably in a way reinforces their beliefs, even as we atheists see it and laugh. So, I mean, comedy can do so much. It can normalize ideas, it can marginalize groups of people, it can change minds, it can teach people things, it can promote conflicting ideals at the same time. It can empower people, it can disenfranchise people. Comedy is incredibly powerful, so I hope that this convinces you to use it wisely. Or don't, I don't care. I'm out of time. Thank you very much, everybody.